you suffer from chronic CFED or can't focus energy drain? Try over-the-counter Vibrin. One tablet contains the same caffeine as a cup of coffee, but without the calories or coffee breath. Vibrin, caffeine, not coffee. Taking Vibrin may result in a lack of drowsiness, improved productivity, and better cash flow from decreased coffee spending. Unexpected job promotions have been associated with Vibrin. Vibrin may decrease the urge to zone out, doze off, or exhibit signs of slacking. All jokes aside, always read the label, take only as directed, and limit caffeine as it may cause real side effects. Not for children under age 12.
Blog Talk Radio.
Yep, yep, bitch, y'all mean breakfast.
Supernatural. wicked. Y'all niggas doubt me, me though. But see how they running everything on the cool. But they know I'm finna act a fool in this motherfucker, nigga. Holla how you do that day.
From Texas to Cali, nigga, we don't care.
Nigga, holla how you do that day.
Missouri, Ohio, nigga, we don't care.
Do that day,
nigga, we don't care.
And niggas holler how you do that day.
California, nigga, we don't care.
We in these streets, anything goes. My cousin in the pen, hitting and I ain't getting swole. Send me a letter, say, P, get your paper. Don't trust these hoes, these niggas, they'll take it. Hustlin' just a hassle, and I'm bringing cash. Popcorn and grits, nigga, trying to get a rag. What about it? Nice stallion to slide. 20-inch bowls with some candy paint to ride. Change in the game cause we sold. Eyes of the red cause the nigga blowing dough. Tied a black shoe string tight on the Reebok. Red a team pass, DKY beat a plastic lot. Hoes bounce their ass, niggas get dealt with. Keep your enemies tight, nigga never think quick. Go out some listen to the homies that are home. R.I.P. to every fucking rapper that is gone. Nigga if you bow, scream it and shout it. It ain't where you're from, every nigga get rowdy.
Supplier. DJ At Low is in the building.
I'm on the block slanging and fed him. a triple B. Ain't no turning back, I'm way too deep. I got prices over my head by niggas in the hood and the police. A young nigga trying to make it. 20 inch rim, 10 and wood, that's why they hate me. Go!
Bring the noise, nigga.
Ain't ready now, you won't ever be ready. They trying to catch me, instead of stacking confetti. It's heavy, but let me explain the game to break the chains of pain and misery. Play my fame throughout this game and remain a misery. Is you peeping my skin? Is you seeing it's real? Is you hurting from hate and making me reach for my steel? Knowing I'm running with ballers instead of clicking with killers. Graveyard filler, I'm out the mighty drug dealers. And bitches love me, paying dues without nothing to lose. Acting a fool, a savage style from the water to Baton Rouge. I'm the cool out, making it pop, it don't stop. Till I stack a million chips, that's off the top. Is you feeling me? I'm willing, it ain't no killing. I bet your life will never be the same for blood spilling. Damn, it's a murder truck, they got me falling like the big boy. I'm shaking up some shit, I thought you knew I'd bring the noise, bitch.
Bring the noise, nigga.
Drops from New Orleans to Memphis, from Atlanta to Miami. It's the South's favorite mixtape supplier. DJ Ad Low is in the building.
What it do, y'all? It's your boy King Eric the Great, and you are now tuned in at Off the Cuff Radio, sponsored by Da Vinci the Clothing Line. And we have the Guillotine in the building. We have my man T Max.
DA all day, 757, we about to do it. What it is, crew.
What it do, my man. And I got, unfortunately, you know, a lot of Sam ain't going to be able to make it tonight due to her absence, but we're going to hold it down for him for this show here. But then we got Miss Chinchilla in the building, about to bring her on right now.
What it do? It's your girl Chinchilla with Dark Name and Force. How y'all doing tonight, T-Max, King Eric the Ruler?
Lady Checks, Rocket Desk, what it up, what up?
Chilling, happy to be here.
And this is going to be a special show right here because we have one of the coldest spitters from the NO. One of the coldest spitters from the South.
Huh.
My man, Young Bleed is in the building right here. Let me bring him on. You on, brother?
Hey.
Hey, now.
What's up, what it do? What's up,
Now we do this with every legend that steps on. We got to give them that round of ovation right here. Got to make these cats respect the game. What's the deal with you tonight, brother? How you living?
Man, pretty good, man. Just getting back to the home front. And let me, you know what I mean? No disrespect, but add a little correction to the collection plate, you know. I'm from BR, actually, man. Baton Rouge. We are BR. G-A-N-G-S-T-E-R, man. So, you know, right down the street from New Orleans, you know, the history peak. And No Limit put me all the way on, man. So, a shout out to New Orleans at the same time, you hear me?
Definitely. Louisiana deep in the house.
Definitely.
We love it.
Definitely
yeah,
got to represent
that. Yeah, it's going down.
Definitely got to represent it for the 504. Definitely got to represent it for the 504. You know, definitely.
I'll let you start it off, T-Max. I'm gonna start it off then, and the T-Max can follow, and Chinchilla can follow. We're gonna build it off from there.
Definitely.
Okay, let's get it on.
For those who are looking for the chop it up with us, the call number is 1-619-924-0703. We're taking donations, cash, shirts, turkeys, all that.
DBT cards, the whole nine.
The whole nine yards, man. But to start this thing off, man, we talking about that new album coming out, man, the Living. What we going to expect from this one in comparison to the other projects?
You know, something old, something new. Actually, I dropped that Living album, like, early this year in February. The new album I got coming out in 2018 is called What a Life, man. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Definitely. Now, in terms of Mr. Booty, go ahead, Chinchilla. Ladies first. Ladies first.
I think that was he talking. I know I sound like a nigga, but it wasn't my nigga sounding ass talking this time, goddamn.
Let's do it. Yo.
But definitely, Mr. Bleed, in terms of, now for a lot of people who may or may not know, while the trap phase in terms of hip-hop is synonymous with the Southern sound, you were one of the first rappers in the 90s to really come with that Southern funk, you know, along with, of course, another notable alumnus of the Baton Rouge hip-hop, Lil Boosie, of course. But also, too, around that time, you know, with David Banner, you know, starting off with Kamikaze with the group Crooked Letters with album Gray Skies, and then also Dirty as well. How did it feel to be coming along in terms of that era of being one of the first wave of Southern rappers, especially down in the Delta, you know, from where, you know, that whole Southern base?
Yeah, you know, it's really evolution, man. When you say the Delta, go back to the blues, man. So we ain't number blues babies, like they say on with the movie Hustle and Flow, you know. Back that thing up, the back door, man, it's the same thing, you know what I'm saying? So Southern rooted, man, Louisiana, Mississippi, and my origins in Texas, you know what I mean? I got family out in the H, actually my grandmother, my daddy and mom is buried in Houston. So my lineage is all the way, you know, the whole Southern pipeline. So, naturally, it's a natural thing for us to come out of this gumbo pot before the industry and the rest of the world take it to us. It's phenomenal, man, still to this day. So, yeah, it's a beautiful thing.
Definitely.
I got to say something about that 8-pound represent Southside. You heard him? I heard him. Keep it going. I'm sorry. You know, I had to get caught for the 8-1 time. And then, you know, I got people in Baton Rouge and New Orleans, Lydell. I got them all over. I'm everywhere. So right now, I'm loving the conversation. He repping every fucking thing right now. So right.
Yeah, right on. Yeah, you know, it's a family affair all the way around the world. It's the same song. You hear me?
Already.
Definitely. Now, in terms of a lot of people,
how you do that though? Yeah, damn it. Keep going. I'm sorry. You know I'm a damn fool. Go ahead.
There it is, though. You said it best. That's how you do it. Move around. Look, get out to know your people, man. We out here.
Huh. Look, it's that Southwest pride, no lie. You know what I'm saying? From Texas to the Lou and all around from Mississippi, you know, it don't miss nowhere. Now, in terms of where a lot of people first, for a lot of people who first heard you was on, you know, the How You Do That there, that was off the, you know, with CeeLo and Master P, of course, off the I'm About It soundtrack. But also, you also had some work with the group Concentration Camp, you know, during the intern as well. But I guess before we talk about your ascent to the rhyme royalty of being such one of the South's regal rappers, take us back to when you was a wee tot, you know, a little pup. How'd you get started in the rap stuff?
Actually, man, I said I'm old as hip-hop. God said the same. I'll be 44 years old come June next year. But we're wanting to take for you, man. I started my penmanship back in 1983. When Run DMC first put out their first album, I was listening to everything before them. I actually had a cousin who used to go to New York from Baton Rouge every year, and he'll come back, he'll take a tape and record Kiss FM with DJ Marley Marl and the original Mr. Magic and DJ Red Alert, and bring me everything from New York before it hit the South, the Rock Kim Ruckus, BDP, well, before BDP, Skylar Rock, rest in peace, you know what I'm saying, the KRS-One. So I have everything down here before it came out here, so that kind of gave me an advantage in the early 80s, man. So I started actually in elementary school by the fourth grade with a poetry teacher learning to write haiku poems. And eventually, it was a kind of like a contest or something like that, where they tested all the elementary schools in the area, and they did this poetry pamphlet. And actually, that pamphlet made it to our state's capital out here. So as a 9-year-old child, I had a poem based off a Run DMC song called Wake Up, where I kind of reformulated and made it my own thing and described my environment and where I was coming from that young. and to reach such a plateau. That amazed me at 9 years old, and that encouraged me to go on from there, along with friends, you know, friends and family, you know, surrounding areas, man. So yeah, my history began in 83.
Man, can I just say something about that? Was a mouthful what he just said, but you know me, I'm always converted because I know we have young listeners. And at the end of the day, that right there, what you said about listening to the haiku poems and all of the poetry and listening in school and that being what helped inspire you, that is real admirable to me, for the simple fact that a lot of kids these days are so quick to say, fuck school, I don't need school, fuck that English class, I don't need English, you know what I'm saying? And they just want to jump off the bridge and go straight into the hip-hop and don't know shit. If you don't know your history, you don't know how to read, write, if you don't know how to form the art itself, if you don't know anything from experience and you're young already, your lyrics can't do shit but be mumble rap, and that's why we're getting a whole bunch of that bullshit these days. So at the end of the day, I'm going to need all of the listeners, especially if you're young and you want to get into the industry, you think that you're talented, please understand, you just heard this man right here. He is wise. He just said that the school is what got him inspired to take it to a level at an early age, at the age of 9. So I just want people to soak that up and process that, because that right there in and of itself is something that people don't really take the time to understand these days. They jump so quick into it, and they wonder why we got this bullshit these days. I love that you said that. Thank you so much for being real.
It's also interesting, too, that he named a lot of the pioneers, too, because that goes to show right there, it's a reflection of his music and a reflection of your longevity, because when you study the pioneers and the people that captivated the game, you'll get knowledge of how they survived and how they laid their craft down. That gives you longevity itself.
Yeah, yeah. That's like studying the hip-hop history. That's paying homage in and of itself. You know, it's not recreating the wheel. You got to learn from somebody. You were saying you said a whole mouthful that was all real. So I just want people to soak that up. He wasn't lying. You paid homage real quick to a whole bunch of legends that are talented in the game. They got longevity, so it's no wonder why you got longevity in the game and you became a legend real quick in the game. So that was lovely.
I don't fall too far from the tree, yeah.
Definitely. And I have to concur with my I have to concur completely with my co-host. Now, in terms of you being, the Southern, I think a lot of people, whether they know or not, you know, the Ghetto Boys, of course, from that down south in Texas, really started off, you know, the revolution for Southern hip hop, of course, where, you know, you follow and others as well. But listening to a lot of the songs that you did, there is a level of lyricism that is practically unheard of now for a lot of these down south rappers now, where I think they need to go back and listen to the blueprint of, you know, some of the stuff you did coming up. I was listening to one particular song you did, Be There, and I mean just listening to how you built the lyrics, how the flow was so polished, how the wording was so intricate, the style was immaculate, the words just poetic. I think this is a situation where people are trying to substitute what is perceived as the it chic, you know, for what the style is today, as a substitute for what concrete concentration of composition is when in MCing. This isn't about rap. This is MCing, and you, from what I've listened to, are the consummate example of an MC.
Yes, sir, and I appreciate that, man. Much respect, dude. So, yeah, it's the same but different thing. Music evolves in its own way, and every generation got their own thing. But I'm the type of guy that learned, and even before my penmanship, when I was born, the day I was born, I almost wasn't supposed to be born. But before then, my mother read me Dr. Seuss while I still was inside of maybe about 8 months to a year, I learned to read Dr. Seuss. So I'm born, you know, an instant rhymer. My uncle played drums, and my grandmother sung in the Southern Baptist Church. And pretty much everybody in the family was talented. So growing up in a household like that with the blues, my granddaddy played the blues on the piano all the time, and made me playing blues records to the day he died. So all those rudiments was there. And like I say, learning from great people that led me back to father great people all the way. I mean, as far as guys, when you're saying MCing, and a lot of guys in the New York area or the East Coast speak of God MCing, and you get to the South, they just starting to kind of coincide, you know, recognize that term and not being so far-fetched. But they go back to just like spreading the kings of Africa or God before them, you know what I mean? It's always a beginning. So I try to study from the Bible to the Quran just to create that knowledge and that wisdom. If you're going to get on that mic, tell me something. Don't tell me the same old thing. I want to hear something that's going to give me that longevity. You know, it's a difference between cooking real grits and cooking instant grits. You know what I'm talking about? So that type of thing, man, you got to go back to know where you come from, know where you're at, to know where to take the people. If you ain't telling me nothing, I can't hear that. You're talking loud and I ain't saying nothing. Back to the ghetto boys, you know, James Brown before that. So if you know that, yeah, we learned from a lot of original records in our time, just kind of made it our own thing. And like I said, coming from a music group, kind of been in so many ways family, just like Pac said with Thug Life. Thug Life and gangsters and all this street shit always existed, but he was the one to diagnose it and put it on a commercial and put it into the world's face. So that's what I did in the same terms of coming from Baton Rouge when a lot of rappers wasn't known, you know what I mean? Me and Boosie's lineage, you know what I mean? He bloodline, down the line, you know what I mean? My younger cousin, you know what I mean? We all but 10 years apart. So off the same block, the same hood, you know, my Uncle C, my Uncle Duke. So what was there, we all eventually picked up on and turned it into something, man. So that's what it do.
Definitely.
So I have a question, because you said you spoke on your everybody, you know, all your relatives, and growing up, you had everybody that was talented some kind of music. We saw in one of your videos,
yeah.
I want to say it was Thuggin' for Life, but I could be wrong, but you were playing a guitar.
Yeah.
Well, can you really play the guitar?
Yeah. I'm learning to play it out one string to the death, and I can play melodies, but learning that overall coordination, I got to get a whole lot of good guitarists around me. So I'm learning. I move so fast between records and touring, so unable to take a class or something like that, I don't really have that time to sit down. So I keep that kind of stuff at the house. I'm a natural drummer. I was my uncle. I've been playing the drums since like 4 or 5 years old. You know what I'm saying? And that type of thing. So yeah, I want to say even bloodline, because my granddad, I get my name Bleed from. He's a Johnson from Mississippi on into Louisiana. So Robert Johnson ain't too far from that. Jack Johnson, Galveston, Texas. I said I come from the greatest, you know, some of the greatest Johnsons that was on the planet. So I listen to a lot of Robert Johnson, father of the blues, rock and roll Hall of Fame for those that don't know, and people that mention the crossroads nowadays, the guy that pulled the soul of soul to the devil at the crossroads. And, you know, come back with his old pioneers. When you're talking Son House and Willie Brown and those guys and from the 20s and 30s for the blues out the Delta in Mississippi, I learned from that and, you know, his peers. He went off and wherever he learned the guitar in an 8-month term and come back and outplayed everybody. Anybody familiar with Robert Johnson left Mississippi, come to Dallas and recorded half of the 29 songs we know him famous for being, didn't live to record a 30th song. And, you know, Jimi Hendrix, Janis Joplin, Amy Winehouse, and Kurt Cobain had all died at 27 years old. He died at 27 years old in that kind of wicked, spiritual kind of way, man, when you're talking back to Mississippi. So I've studied those guys. So when you see me doing that, it's a lot of reference I give and a lot of rhymes is back to Robert Johnson and kind of picking off, you know, from my bloodline and tree and just trying to, you know, turn the blues and the rap more or less and make it all one thing. So, yeah, it go a lot of ways with me, dude.
Huh.
Yeah,
country
rap tunes.
Look, I'm recipe to my dude, recipe to my big bro, Chad Pimp C. Butler. Yeah, you know what I mean? Rather hip hop or crip hop. You know what I mean? From the east to the west coast, and like you say, to rap a lot, shout out to Lil J. You know what I mean? And that whole beginning for the south, even coming up and having independence into a major way. Yeah, you know, like Pimp say, man, you know, if you don't want to consider it hip hop down here, yeah, we make country rap tunes, man. That's what that is. Yeah.
Hooray.
Hey, look, I want to add this to you since you're talking on H-Town, man, just off the family tree. Shout out to my uncle out there, Freck Williams and his daughter, Yaya Williams. A lot of people might know her for doing a lot of, you know, hair and different stuff like that and hair contests. She go all over the world. But that's my first cousin, my uncle, Freck. Rest in peace to Tukey Williams. They all Williams. That took again from New Orleans. So it's a whole lot of stuff that's just in the family. But I mentioned Frick to let everybody know. True story, I'm going to try to say this short. But when I was young, Buzz Reynolds called the family house and wanted, you know, me and my mother to be in a movie due to my Uncle Frick having the connection to movies. He used to work, I want to say he worked for Rap-A-Lot for a little while once he moved from Baton Rouge in the 80s on out to Houston. But way in the beginning, he was in two of the original Slade movies, Mandingo and The Miseducation of James Pittman. You know what I'm saying? So he played that type of, he was that type of guy. So having that type of family connect, my granddad and Rudy Ray Moore was cool when it comes to Baton Rouge, you know, my granddad. So I had all those guys, and actually a guy that called for me to be in a movie with my mother when I was a baby. He wanted to do a breastfeeding scene, but you know how a black man is and how my daddy was at the time, that ain't never go down. So, but it was Burt Reynolds, man. I had all that to look up to, so I always felt like I was destined for some type of stardom. So I had a lot of pushes in a lot of different ways, and I found my glitch, like I said, here again in 83, listening to a Run DMC record, or listening to, I want to say in particular, Run DMC. We emulated them, and I didn't start solo as a child. I had a friend of mine by the name of Devin Williams that we used to call OD on the street, that we started as a duo. You know, we used to have a group called Silk and Slim, and that's where I've been, you know, skinny guy all my life, so I took the Slim. For one of my OG cousins out here by the name of Super Slim, man. You know, Super Slim do a lot of Stop the Killing programs and stuff with Baton Rouge. And he's world renowned from here to the Nation of Islam and so on and so forth. So I watched a lot of street cats turn their life over and start doing things positive that I looked up to. And after taking the name from Slim was my first rap name. And from there, me and my guy kind of separated due to families moving around. And we didn't wake up across the street from each other every day. And I kept pushing the dream. So, you know, that's my evolution, man, as we speak.
Definitely. I mean, look, this interview right now is so far incredible in terms of the amount of history that you have given us from the roots with Robert Johnson, you know, Willie Dixon. And for a lot of people who may not know about Robert Johnson, there's also a movie by the name of Crossroads in 1980, from 1985 with Ralph Macchio. It is also loosely based. It's an interpolation of his story as well. The musical appreciation that you have from not only East Coast hip hop to the roots of, you know, the blues and the Delta, because really if you look at it from where hip hop is, it's a more stylized version of the laments. You know, basically it takes the formula of the blues in terms of, you know, the everyday struggles that, you know, black people endure, you know, and, you know, it just is an updated version of it as well.
Definitely.
Now, we talked about you being a pup coming up, so let's talk about when you actually got on Major and starting with Concentration Camp with CeeLo. How did that come about in terms of when you actually really started taking it serious? And before that, when did you know that maybe you could do this for a living?
Rewind the tape here again. Somewhere about middle school area, 11, 12 years old, I met Lope. We've been homeboys since we was young. And actually, his dream was to be a DJ. And I was always the young rapper, so I used to battle in the commons area at school, battle on the block, backyard parties. So I kind of had that thing going on where everybody knew me and, you know, different guys throughout the city. We'd see cross each other, you know, come across each other, and we'll battle rap. Everything was non-confrontational, you know, for what it is nowadays. But all respect due to each other, you know what I mean? It helped shape each other and mold all the craft. But Loke was my DJ guy when we was about in middle school. So we always had that hip-hop dream together. Later on in life, I want to say, if we was 12, seven, eight years later, we reunited in the streets. And actually, I used to sell a tape on a street corner where we used to hustle at. Same apartment he lived in, it was right off the block that I was raised on. So it was Garfield Street in South Baton Rouge, at the bottom of South Baton Rouge, same street Booth is from. So everything was kind of in that same, in that New York kind of chemistry, as far as the Bronx and Brooklyn and the evolution of hip hop. It was taking place down here, but on a smaller scale. So me and Lowe was one of those type of pioneers. And later on in life, I went through a production company. Shout out to my guy, Michael B. Williams, out here with his old school cat. Really, was in his early 30s. And I may have been 14, 15, but he was from Cleveland, Ohio, and, you know, helped put out an arm and the whole Sterling family out here, man, helped me put out my first tape that I used to sell in the corner. About a year after that, Lope started, or somewhere around that time, he had started CeeLo Records. And we reunited, and I got in on the end part of his first solo album, Who's Gonna Ride. Brought him to the studio, let me hear what he had been doing. And naturally, I started doing some stuff to add to it. And then we became together, me, him, and my guy Lee Tam, and a whole lot of guys that helped push that label off the ground from Baton Rouge. So I'm actually the founder of the concentration camp. I come back with an idea to him that I passed on to him when I started to see the people it accumulated, the other artists in the town and all that. And I said, well, we need a name that's beyond just CeeLo Records, because now we got an umbrella. So I come up with the term concentration camp due to the fact that, here again, my name is Young Bleed, based on my grandfather's name being Good Bleed, which was a World War II veteran, hell of a man in these streets out here, Baton Rouge, man, and so on and so forth. So off of that, I learned about the war, the World War II war with the Hitler war. I'm born on D-Day, June 6th, was the day that war ended. So my
Normandy,
whole life,
Normandy
yeah,
invasion,
come up
yes.
With,
yeah.
You know what I mean? So my whole arm. So from there, you know, I studied the diary of Anne Frank as well as anybody else, you know, when you ran across that in school. So I learned a lot about the Holocaust and the slaughter of the Jews and kind of related that to the genocide of slavery and what we still going through in the street for crack and killing and so on and so forth, and come up with that term and say, you know, it's more like a purgatory, but you know what I mean? When you come to that fork in the road, you know, it's two ways to the street, the graveyard, the penitentiary. So the purgatory was kind of the camp, you know what I mean? I said I broke the word down, C-O-N, really apostrophe, centration camp, a camp that we sent to concentrate and do something else positive. So that was my whole, you know, aspect of what the concentration camp would become. And a lot of us would come through that outlet. Local had a few hood houses that we would put the studio in, and everybody was welcome to come through and at least take a chance of making the records. And that gave a foundation to a lot of us that come from under that umbrella. But due to my partner, yeah, we've been partners since kids and had that dream to put our heads together, and that's what we came up with.
Now, the main concentration camp, did it kind of like rub labels the wrong way when y'all was shopping for a deal?
Yeah, look, I'm glad you brought that up. When they talking Illuminati and all that nowadays, I want to say, if not anybody, you know, shout out to my big bro, Sheba, on the West Coast, that I know had been locked up for doing an album in 98, which was called To My Casket Drop, mentioning the pot killings and police killings and different things that was happening in California. But we kind of got the similar flagging as well as NWA and the Fuck the Police record. But when we did that, I want to say, you know, the head of priorities was a Jew kind of stabulation. So when that hit the table, I want to say one of the rabbis from the Jews wanted to boycott that record. Then Brian Turner, you know, which is the CEO of Priority, you know, brought me to the forefront to explain it. Once I explained that, I said, I'm not trying to separate black and Jewish people. I'm trying to say we have something in common for us struggling and being in it under any kind of oppression. So when they recognized that and me telling them just what I told y'all, that it wasn't just something, a name, a fancy name that I decided to call us. I knew my history as far as the Holocaust and all that, you know what I mean? So they kind of pulled it, well, they really pulled that boycott out and allowed us to do whatever we wanted to do from that. So, yeah, we were some of the first to get that kind of, you know, yeah, that kind of flack for a record like that. Yes, sir.
That's what it is.
Today,
you know.
And that's the trip about the labels right there,
that?
Because they probably thought at first that you was gonna use it for shock value just to sell records, but as soon as you dropped the true origins of what the meaning of the name and based off your family history, he had no choice but to soak it up.
Yeah. Right, you know, yeah, on guard, man. So yeah, that come down, man. So you know, message of prophecy, man. People need to know. I try to keep a message in the music, no matter how fancy fly it is. I try to put something in that you can learn. I just started, my favorite rapper of all time has always been Rakim, with his carnage and brutalness, but in a polite way, where he don't say a whole lot of motherfucking shit, goddamn, but he don't get his point across. I ain't no joke. You know what I mean? That kind of serious of a guy. And I always learned vocabulary words and stuff that they wasn't teaching me in school, which would make me follow my education. My pops used to tell me to get two education. Learn them books since, and learn the street sense, man, you know, and the most important, the common sense. So, yeah, that'll send me back to the lab without a mic to grab. Every time I thought I was tight as Rakim, a Rakim record will come out and hit some new shit, and that'll take me and make me have to go pick up a dictionary to define that word.
Yeah,
Yep.
For real.
Yep. That's what it is. And we got to, and, you know, you mentioned SIBO. Shout out to the 916 in Sacramento. SIBO, a living legend out there on the West Coast. We love you all out there. This is Off the Cuff Radio King Eric the Ruler and Lady Chinchilla and T-Max the Facts. We are here with Young Blee. Calling number is 1-619-924-0703. Sponsored by Da Vinci Clothing. Now,
there,
you told us about... So what now?
I said we out there.
Oh, yes, we're out there. We're out there. Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. Check us out. Check us out. Off the Cuff Radio, The Guillotine. Now, Bleed, you told us about the first chapter of how you started with Concentration Camp. Now, there was, you know, some guy by the name, some dude from New Orleans, you know, had a record company named No Limit, started in Richmond, California, laid the blueprint. His name was Master P, who is one of the masterminding, magnificent moguls of music history, especially during the 90s era. How did that come about with you linking up with No Limit Records to really do, you know, the how you do that there? How do you and CeeLo hook up with Master P for that? Because what I understand, was that a remix or was that the actual version, the original version of the song?
Nah, next time you listen to that song, and I'll listen to it, it is real low in the beginning where P say remix. You know what I'm saying? So let me give you the origin. P had knew each other between that move in New Orleans. They were in cahoots with each other. You know, we was camp based, and eventually he started to bring me around. So we recognized each other. In the midst of that, we was doing the first Concentration Camp self-titled album. And I guess, you know, P, some way or another, through Lowe, got wind of that record. And I was offered to do a remix, you know what I mean, a deal with Priority Records, the video, the whole nine. So all that kind of fell in place, you know, in the summer of 97. Is when I actually went out and I signed it on Priority Records, but we did the remix based off of, I mean, you know, coming off that Concentration Camp album. Once we started to do that and I passed that idea to Lo, then he went further than just putting out solo records. And the first Clickolation album was that Concentration album, Concentration Camp album that displayed everybody. So my first solo joint just was me, without just featuring on the a CeeLo record from Who's Gonna Ride to whatever. And I want to say the third CeeLo record release was that Concentration Camp album, where I did the original How You Do That. That really, I called it a fool. You know what I mean? Not in the sense of dumbness, but I was saying, I was so inspired about it. I was saying, when people hear this, they're going to say, that's a fool. That's what I'm going to call it. You know what I mean? So you hear me saying, act a fool. And back to, you know, the OG origin, you know, I used to love the King T act a fool, the Johnny Guitar Watson sample. So I come up with all
those
records.
Man.
You know,
took it back with King
so,
T, yes. Yes, go on,
please. Yeah, that inspired me, man. You know, I used to steal my papa records and break his knees young. I've been mixing and scratching and stuff since I was 12 at the same token. When I learned to rhyme about 8 and 9, then, different people and who are DJs that helped me to what a realistic mixer was and what a 1200 and regular turntables, how to put the penny or, you know, different things to keep it from scratching. So I'll be in the back room like a Brooklyn child, but a baby back Louis with all the LL posters, the radio and all that on my wall. And I'll be, you know, wake up like B Street and break it. You know what I'm talking about? Crush Groove. So I was living like that. And right around in the neighborhood with such, you know, all the other kids, you know, we had different things. A couple of DJ guys, we are right up the road, you know what I mean? That's my friends and family to this day. And we'll do the house party. You know, one of my OG DJ guys, he used to make the tapes and sell them, just like GQ did on Juice or what have we. So, you know, that type of here again, evolution was happening here. And we'll recognize each other in the street, guys that were fond of music. Hey, man, you rapper, you DJ. So I had started getting connected real young in the street with just the community. And that's the makings of me here again. A lot of people found me and started putting me in the studios early, about 11 years old, and so on and so forth. But, yeah, man, back to that. Yeah, like I said, there's so many ways for it opened up different changes and chapters for me. But, yeah, pretty much there.
Yeah, take your time. Tell us everything. Yeah, tell us everything.
Right, right. Well, yeah, pretty much, you know, that combination of music and, like you say, combining yourself with all those elements, it kind of poured out me in a 3-4-dimensional way to where I grew up listening to Parliament Records or what have we. My pops and my Uncle Fred being here on H-Town, I inherited their records when the CD Evolution came. So I still have all their records, 1,200 crates and, you know what I mean, cases and all that type of thing. So when if I produce a beat, and then I produce how you do that, but I didn't take the credit for it. Shouts out to Happy Perez out to H-Town there, you know what I mean, and Free South, you know, South Park, Mexican. They from the same place. But Happy was living in Baton Rouge at the time. So due to the computer technology and change, I come back from recording all real to real to DATs and ADATs and stuff like that. So those guys were a little younger than me, a little bit more technical. So I had those grooves in me and kind of laid out a format on paper of how I wanted that track to sound. And that went to a Parliament record, which was called, it's on a Motor Buddha Affair record. That's called One of Those Funky Things. I always loved that bass line, that song. So I took that bass line, I want to say added it to some UTFO drums and some Public Enemy drums, you know what I mean, with the drum format. I laid the drums, and he played the bass line on top of it versus sampling it rock from Rock Steady off of Aretha Franklin record and the Yeah, Yeah, Yeahs off of Earth, Wind & Fire record, you know what I mean? So combining all those elements was kind of like the cake and the cream, you know what I mean, or the paste on top of it. With the wordplay. So I sat back and, like I said, mixed that in my head like a DJ passed the idea to Hap, and Hap, you know what I mean, pretty much laid it down and computer programmed it, and I put the wordplay on top of it, and pretty much the rest is history.
You realize you just took us roughly through over 30 years in terms of the call, actually 40 when you count Parliament Funkadelic. I mean, you're taking us from the original funk layer players down to the 80s with the modern-day hip-hop evolution, because you mentioned the 1200s. For our listeners out there, you have to understand the knowledge. You have to understand the knowledge and wisdom that this man is giving in terms of the foundation of two turntables and a microphone with the SP-1200s on the 1 and 2s, mixing and cutting, what you do. And laying the samples down. Now, and you also mentioned, of course, South Park Mexican, who had Dope House Records.
Yeah.
He had a situation that, you know, unfortunately, you know, landed him doing, you know, some time. We all know about that. Okay. Now we get to the cooking of the class of the classic. So when the classic becomes a classic, what was the reaction for you, that elation, that excitement, that incredulous feeling that you felt when this song took off? How did that feel?
Well, first of all, it was that strong in my spirit, so I had to turn it into real life. So once we was able to duplicate what was in my head, then that, you know, increased the inspiration toward that. By the time it hit the ground, that's all you were hearing in every car from any part of Louisiana you went. So just starting at the turf, I had a good friend of mine by the name of Jewel Jackson that became a top radio DJ at 94.1, the radio station out here that didn't exist at one time. We used to have Q106 and for FM and for AM and the WXOK. So I had been on the radio. I knew the old guys, Guy Brody, Night Prince, and all those guys, you know what I mean, used to groom me and link me into talent shows in different schools from here to Southern University. So as a kid, you know, I was always in the midst of that. My first record I had out about 17 was called Much Love, where I hear again use the Friends drums from Houdini. Shout out to Houdini. And just the drum part beginning without the music, but on top of it, I sampled the Bar K's You Can't Run Away From My Love. Everybody loved that track. I put the wordplay on. Yeah, you know what I mean? Put those together, and that was my first radio song that they played 2-3 times a day, just in all, you know, in Baton Rouge alone. So later, when that record come out, my guy Jewel used to have a group together with a female rapper as well. He was a rapper, but a beat maker with just a regular beat machine. A few years older than me and a girl by the name I used to call her MC Delight. You know, instead of MC Light, she was MC Delight. And she was all the projects out here, you know, the same way a lot of girls come up and real hard corn. And she was like the alter ego for as hard as I spit as a meal. She was like my partner in line that could point, you know, that can click with the females on the same level, beautiful but deadly. So in that same sense, we had a group called the Bayou Posse. But Jewel's dream was to be a radio DJ. So, you know, his dream came true. when 94.1 started. He was the first DJ to set it off. So I had an inside link to him, and what I did was as a personal favor and thanks to him was remake How You Do That just for his introduction when he came on the radio at night. So naturally, he'll play that when he came on, and he'll play my original song that started about number 9 and it's Hot 9 at 9 or something like that, maybe on a Monday. By Friday, it was number 1 in the city, and it started to take off and run and spread to New Orleans and pretty much the whole Gulf Coast. So a lot of people for the southern region know about that original song. When you get out into the country and the rest of the world, they know the P version because P had a bigger hand and was 100 steps in the game beyond what we were as far as No Limit at the time. So pretty much like that. Once he got it, he liked it so much that I think he turned it on to Priority Records. They liked it so much they called me to California. And the week or the weekend that I stayed, I signed the deal, and when I come back home, it was a whole other ball game, man. So, yeah, been running ever since, 20 years later.
And you crafted the My Balls and My Word album, which was possibly one of the best albums of 98. Now, I wanted to ask you, what was the story behind the cover? Because the cover is pretty unique.
Okay, so what we're talking about here, you're going to see it clear as day now. It's going to trip everybody off. Originally, you know, everybody used to go to Pen and Pixel out there in Houston and, you know, shoot those candy-coated album covers that everybody became famous for in the southern region. Well, me, I wanted to do the same but different with not just the ball aspect to show the other side. I wanted to kind of go back to the Delta and bring you from a dirt road and walk you into where my career became, kind of looking at the game like a viewfinder through my eyes. So I took a backwards picture, you see, with the suit and the cane. You know, my pops always telling me, man, people can wear a suit and joke with me about that. But in my left hand is a Bible, and my right hand is a cane. So, you know, how the riddle goes, say, which one's been born, you know, start on 4 limbs, in your middle of your life, you're walking on 2, and the end of your life, you're walking on 3 legs. So, you know, that's a riddle for people that don't know, but the answer to that is a man. When you're a baby, you're crawling. You know what I mean? Once you stand up and be erected, you know what I mean?
The riddle of the Sphinx with Odysseus. Not Odysseus, but yeah, the riddle of the Sphinx.
Right. So at the end, if you live long enough, you know what I mean? When your body starts to break down, you may have to walk on a cane. So I captured those elements, but the imagery was really, you know, kind of like when you mentioned the movie earlier, The Crossroads. I wanted to take like a Robert Johnson blues man kind of picture. And really, I wanted to shoot a picture of the crossroads there. But once I turned that idea into PM, what I got back is what the world knows now. And I transformed that, you know, picture said 1,000 words. So when you're looking at it now, you see the two tigers that's behind me. A Stairway to Heaven, which is the bridge between the heavens and the earth, and a mini mansion in the sky. You know what I mean? So going back there, that was a whole nother significance. I agree with that. Versus that, and that still bring you on the path here again from the heaven to the earth back to God. So, yeah, that's the science to that, man, all the way around.
Man,
that took some creativity, some deep thinking, and a real vision right there to make what we see today, because that is a live-ass album cover. A live-ass album, too, but that cover right there is so strong, and you just made a whole. If somebody never even saw the picture, you just described it in such a pictorial way that somebody could envision what you just did. That was lovely, and that's some deep ass shit.
You made them cats really put they work in for that one. You made them do some deep second and third train of thought thinking. Like,
right.
You got to put that work in.
No doubt.
Right.
I mean, definitely. And we got to give, of course, you mentioned Pen and Pixel Graphics. Shout out to Mikhail Senhue Kather of, you know, the proprietor, the property manager, the intellectual, you know, superb all genius of Pen and Pixel Graphics.
Mm-hmm.
Much respect, because you did so much for us out there, Mikhail. We thank you so much and what you're still doing today. So it's like, and taking a step back for a second before we jump ahead again. Oh, how does it feel when you heard Problem use that beat for his jam? How did that feel knowing that, you know, almost 20 years after that song still resonated? Because I think it would also be fair to say that for when the Bay Area, you know, started, and even though Problem is from L.A., that, yeah, what you had there with P, because a lot of people don't know that P started off in Richmond, California, which is the Bay. That song, dare I say, would probably lay the foundation for what would be known or the modern day foundation for mob music in terms of the heavy bass lines and all of that. You know, some could say E-40 started the Bay, but you all definitely expanded on that sonic. I mean, did you know it was going to have that type of impact? Oh, go ahead.
You said, yeah, I was just adding Too Short as far as, you know what I mean, that whole Bay Area in the early, in the late 80s, you know what I mean, as far as that Oakland
right,
sound and all
first.
That.
Right, he was the first.
The heavy,
yes, he was the first.
Yeah, yeah. Uncle Tia, man. So, yeah, what would you have asked me again? We were talking at the same time, so I kind of didn't hear
you. Oh, yeah, yeah, but I mean, but definitely. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. But, I mean, but that was like, but to have a song that just reaches so much, and even today, so we've gone from Concentration Camps to, you know, the song to the album.
Yeah.
So what was that time like during, you know, because you and P were synonymous with what was going on during the Down South with the Ascent during that time, because also, and you come from Louisiana, so there were a lot of other groups there during that time as well in terms of UNLV. And, of course, some label that was called, you know, Cash Money Records. It was on the come up as well. Then when y'all made y'all hit in 97, although Cash Money started in 1990, 1998 was when they were pretty much on the national radar. So we're seeing during this late 90s period, New Orleans rap, you know, with the bounce sound, of course, just taking off, you know, just it's a new wave of hip hop that for the listening audience, nation and worldwide, was not familiar with. They became familiar with real quick. Yeah. How does it feel to how to see all of that just come up? And did you interact with a lot of those guys along the way as well?
Yeah, definitely. You know, I mean, the New Orleans being a bigger city, and in one sense, it's more musically based. We'll have to go to New Orleans and, you know, edit our videos and commercials at Cox Cable and stuff like that. And a lot of those guys will come in and out. Then naturally, you know, we wind the tape a little bit for you with a camp called a boot camp kick that birthed your school, the Ghetto Twins, Black Menace, and so on and so forth. Yeah. So I spent the time with you. Mm-hmm. You know, shout out to Precise. I've been in the studio with him and the Ghetto Twins late at night along with Lope. So, yeah, we all interacted. And to go even farther, even before No Limit and Cash Money, you can't forget about Big Mike, and rest in peace to Tim Smooth, was the first guys to come out of New Orleans and go to rap a lot. You see what I'm saying? With the convicts, when you're talking Big Mike, rest in peace to 3-2 with my guys in real life, you know what I mean? So other than Bust Down, I want to say Bust Down was an artist that some people know about, and it's definitely in the southern region, but he went out to Luke Skywalker Records, you know, with Luke. So at one time in the South, the only Black-owned record companies we had that was independent and respected eventually worldwide was Rap-A-Lot and Luke Skywalker Records, you know, Uncle Luke out there in Miami. And then eventually, you know, shout out to Gregory D and the Ninja Fresh crew that Manny Fresh was a DJ for. You see what I'm saying? So I go way back with those guys, you know what I mean? So just watching and just having and wondering what was the possibility of any of us from the boot state, getting on at New York, in New York at the time, being a long way from home. So I respect those guys, Lil J, the Uncle Luke, for having some kind of outlet to put Southern hip-hop here again on the map from Texas all the way to Florida. So everybody on the in-between, that's all we had to look up to. And I'm sure that inspired Master P along the way. That inspired Baby and Rhino for his Cash Money. But those were the cornerstones for the song. Amen.
Things that you learned from P that you really took on the independent lane for your career.
Yeah, man. You said what's that again about him?
Yeah. I was asking what is the most advice that you learned from P in terms of further your career to where it's at now?
A lot of what seeing and doing. You know, the times I was around P and from Baton Rouge to New Orleans to California, I got a chance to learn and see how videos work, how the business ran. You know, like I said, he walked me into my first major deal. So going from all but zero to infinity for what we was doing down here, small scale, all but overnight, once we had that link, and I'm sure that was in the mix for a while, but, you know, for me to go from Baton Rouge to Hollywood, yeah, man, it was a whole, I was about 22, 23 years old. Well, I say 23, I turned 23 that summer, 97. So going into that, I was still a kid, man, in one sense of the word, coming off the 18 and 19, you know what I mean? That type of thing. So it was real overwhelming. I had to catch on, you know, and just, you know, being the quiet guy in the corner, you know what I mean? I was the sponge that would soak up everything. So I learned a lot just being around, you know, shouts out here again to people welcoming me in, man, in that sense of the word. Yeah.
Man, I mean, this is just the memories. I mean, just reliving that whole era and watching a whole new wave of hip-hop that y'all helped usher in. I don't think we can thank y'all enough for really expanding the palette for what y'all contributed. I mean, you know, you definitely laid down the new wave. Now, we go from your first album to your second album, My Own. How did that come about?
Do me a favor. Remember that question, and let me back up a little bit because it's something I didn't conclude on that you asked me about.
Please,
just back
look, this is you. Whatever you, about. Please, tell us, whatever. Yes,
your
yes,
platform,
go ahead,
brother.
Go ahead.
Okay, look, you mentioned Problem earlier, and to conclude that, the way that went, at the time, the Priority Records, I became real good friends with a top executive at the time by the name of David Weiner, the first man to walk me off the plane and introduce me to California, passed me right by the murder scene where Biggie had been murdered and was on our way to Priority Records and just kind of giving me the rudiments of how real it was in Cali and what was going on. Welcome to Priority Records. So shouts out to Dave Weiner that eventually years later became vice president at Strange Music. Strange Music with Tech N9ne and those guys. So recently in 2010, I signed a deal with those guys with Dave Vulture. Got a chance to meet Travis O'Gwynn and Tech N9ne. And in the midst of that, we was touring. And if anybody's familiar with J-Rock and Kendrick Lamar, you know, those guys that come from Top Dog Entertainment. I had
yes,
this
Compton
my label,
and the Knicks.
Sports.
Yes.
Well, right. So I just started my label to do a co-op deal with those guys that's called Trapdoor Entertainment. So I was looking at J-Rock backstage with a cap on and saying, man, TBE, what's the name of your label? Top Dog. I said, it's the same initiative as my label. So we clicked off the bat and been homies ever since. So after I left Strange, I want to say, or right before I left Strange, I get a call. We actually remade the song. Me, Brother Lynch, and Tech N9ne did a song, did a How You Do That Again, that some people tagged and didn't take off like we expected it to do, you know, minus. But a year later, or somewhere within that six-month frame, J-Rock Hype Man, people know him as Magnum P.I. or as King, you know, as well as, you know, coming out the Top Dog umbrella, called me one day and had a young guy on the phone and say, it's my young homie I went to school with. He redid your song and wanted to know if it was okay and put him on the phone, and that guy was a problem. So he actually sent me that song. We read y'all to each other way in the beginning before it hit the world. So by the time it hit the world, everybody felt like he stole the song. I was getting all kind of calls across the country, and I was like, nah, that's the homie from out there. And what I told Problem, I said, man, if anything, I appreciate you doing the one thing that anybody that stole a chapter of that song, said how you do that in the record that I wasn't connected to, didn't give me those phone calls, you at least said my name. So I appreciate and respected that, man, that you pay respect and homage. That's like a young guy supposed to do to the OGs. And that's all we're saying from an OG level. We ain't the money and your girlfriends, man, just say my name. As well as God say my name, man. Don't forget the place and the person you got it from. So that's all, and that's just respect and homage to the game. So here again, shout out to Problem to conclude that you did.
Rare, you know what I mean? Rap game, because a lot of these guys just take lines and samples and songs and don't acknowledge anything. And they're like they just created the whole thing themselves. But so for Problem to do that, that's a big look right there.
You know, and ladies,
that's one thing I won't let. If it just come up to me and I know they sample some music or something, I won't even push the music. I won't send it to a record. I won't do anything for them if they didn't get that sample cleared. If they didn't talk to the owner first, something, I don't fuck with it. And it's for many reasons, not only the lawsuits and all that, but at the end of the day, it's out of respect. Because if your shit get big,
then what are you saying to the nigga that came, that did it first, and you took it from him? If you didn't get permission in any kind of way, my nigga, I don't want no parts of it, because I ain't that disrespectful type bitch. I don't care about the money like that. I'd rather have respect in the game right before I get the money, nigga. Fuck this shit.
So exactly. Shout out to that.
And more than anything, mm-hmm. I mean, you gotta respect the beat architect. You know, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, that song, "The Problem," like what? This is the man we are interviewing. Mm-hmm. Who, where it came from? Where, how you do that there? You know, and I think also too, for where it is in hip hop, you know, we have seen a very abysmal, abhorrent, and outright egregious dismissal of the elders by some of the younger generation. Not all of them, but some. And especially the beat biting, jaw dropping, take a big chunk. Like we have the legend of Coach from Filmo rapping Forte, and a certain rapper, if y'all do y'all Bing search, who basically just swagger jacked his whole song Players Club, well, at least the first verse, without giving him credit.
Yes, sir.
Yes, we're not going to say this artist's name, but if you're in the loop, you know, with the scoop, you already know who eventually had to pay up that dough, because what I understand, he actually had to give Rap and Forte that money, you know, for jacking his style. Yeah. What do you feel about right now where the disconnect is? Between the younger generation and the older generation, where do you think that there is really that much of a chasm of conflict in reference to the roots of where the integrity of the culture is not being preserved, where the older generation feels this, and where the younger generation feels that it's their time, and that, you know, basically the old guard is trying to prohibit them from the progress? Where is the divide, and how can we build that bridge instead of having, you know, the gasoline on it and somebody is just waiting to ignite it, to burn it up where nobody can crawl side to side?
Well, it goes two ways for me. One is lack of knowledge, just not knowing, you know what I mean, for those guys that were just born yesterday and like music and just hop on it there. But the other is the lack of respect, where these guys feel like, okay, man, you're old now, y'all, that's a form of disrespect. And a great form of pre-Haitian, you see what I'm saying? And when I say this, from the street game to the rap game, you know what I mean? We used to look up to that old dope dealer, that old player that was down the block, and a girl coming, the Cadillac coming, hey, that's the guy I want to be like. But discrediting him is like discrediting God. It's like you started life in the book of life that taught you how to survive, that taught you how to make your penance from heaven. So here again, you can't know what you know what I mean? You can't know no map where you come from to know why you even there and why you even inspired by music. If people weren't making music before you, you just didn't start music. This didn't start in 2000, man. So I have a problem right there. And I'm to any youngster that's willing to listen and learn, just like I was you know what I mean, a knowledge-hungry youngster, you know what I mean, just to increase my game. I want to know what those guys talking about. They, you know, their conversation stretch a little longer than my five-minute conversation, you know what I mean? You run out of gas, you got to go back to the gas station. So if you don't burn those bridges, you could always go back to that gas station and get you some gas, man. So that's like the grass growing without the sun, man. One don't go without the other. So you can never forget that. So I try to pass that on to them to give them the same longevity I have, just by respecting the people in the game and respecting the game. The game gonna respect you. Yeah.
It's very rare you see that type of mentality in the NO anyway, because it seems like if anything, the whole vibe is very much everybody vibes with one another, collabs with one another, which leads to you collabing with Boosie, who was an up and comer at the time after your generation.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So, you know what I mean? It's all about that, man. Yeah, it's all about that respect at the end of the day. That's like the bomb, man. Basic instructions before you leave the earth. Right? You're going to get in the kingdom of heaven. Like my pops would tell my brother all the time, hey, man, how you going to play the game without reading the instructions? How you expect to win?
Real.
You know what I'm saying? So it's a point. Yeah, that's a lack of common sense. Yeah, it's like ain't nobody catch you nothing. Somebody can keep you up, man. Yeah.
He said common sense a few times. You said common sense a few times. You said common sense a few times, and that's what you need to have. But you know what? These days, I don't know if it's lack of respect or lack of knowledge, but common sense ain't so common no more, and it's sad. It really is.
You know, and I think the problem is, go ahead.
Yeah, it's the breaking of the foundation. And here again, back to the Bible or what have we, just real life, you know, rather you read or you don't read, just take a look around. It's foundation, and like I say, it's written when I mentioned the Bible that the father's going to be against the son's going to be against the father, as well as the mothers and the daughters. So it's to come to pass. So I feel like we'll get over that hump, you know what I mean, once everybody get a little bit more attentive, more so when a youngster go through some things and you need somebody, like going to jail and think you're going to whoop everybody in jail. Ain't going to happen. You got to, you know what I mean, kick the suffering, you know what I mean? You got to watch you. You got to watch this and respect your surroundings. Anything discouraging, man, they have a way of being removed, you know what I mean? If it's not a part of that universal cycle, it's God before us, and if you spell God backwards, I say D-O-G, man. So you want to get to some game, get to some game from the big man, but that's where we all get it from, you know what I mean? It wouldn't be no love without God, so how can you say, yeah, you started the day and you got it from here? Now, man, you're going to run out of something, and you're going to have to back paddle. I was always told, do it right, the first time. Do it right the first time, you ain't got to worry about doing it again. Stay ready, you ain't got to get ready. You hear me?
I just feel like that spiritual awareness is just lacking in today's music, and because it's focused on one side of the coin. It's not focusing on the side, which is life and death. Like, they're not really promoting the death side. Like, what's the consequence?
It's an interview or documentary or something that Tupac mentioned this. He said, you know, if you look down the block, it might be one man on that whole block that's really a father to his child, or, you know, a man to his wife, woman, or what have we. That foundation has been corrupted and to some degree all but destroyed. So when you don't have no leadership, you see what I'm saying? That go from out the house into the communities, and we mentioned Martin Luther King and Malcolm X and all that type of thing earlier. Without that leadership, especially in the black community, you know, we young renegades and don't know what to follow. So I understand the youth. Peter Tosh, you know what I mean, the Jamaican artist that was a part of the Wellers with Bob Marley. One of my favorite songs from him is called You Can't Blame the Youth. So if you lying to them in the school books and teachers, what you expect them to do when they find out the truth? Turn the house over, same as Jesus did. Yeah, you know what I mean? Hey, man, this is a house of prayer. Y'all from here gambling, man. This ain't what my pop is about, man. You know what I'm saying? So it's about this. So without that father structure, a lot of single mothers and a lot of single fathers for that matter, without that family structure, you're kind of off balance. If you taught everything by a woman, you're going to have a woman way. If you taught everything by a man, you might be a chauvinist. But if you got the best of both worlds, that gives you a different kind of balance. You dig? Well, I come from a broken home. You know, I'm raised by step-pops from out of Ninth Ward, New Orleans. My dad is from Baton Rouge. So when you talk New Orleans and Baton Rouge, it gave me an ultimate balance to where by the time I met a Master P or whoever, I was ready. I mean, my grandfather being a veteran, you know what I mean? He died in New Orleans Veteran Hospital. So, you know, that gave me the option of going back and forth, you know what I mean, between those worlds ever since a child. So I was ready for New Orleans, and New Orleans was ready for me. And again, the rest is history. But it's that foundation, man, that gives you that balance. Rather, my pops from New Orleans always tell me, man, you know, rather blood in or blood out, we family. You see what I'm saying? So wherever you get your learning from, if that's a hard street corner, if that's a penitentiary, God gonna send somebody to you in the form that you need to reconcile with yourself. You know what I mean? You can run and run, like Bob Marley said, but you can't run away from yourself. So eventually, that common knowledge of being has to kick in. You know what I mean? Past the drugs, sex, and the rock and roll. You got to be one with yourself and one with God to wake up tomorrow. You see what I'm saying? Or eventually, yeah, you run out of gas, man.
For real. And, you know, along with that, too, you talked a lot about the family structure and having leadership. Some of the youth and even some of the older teens and young adults, that even if they have leadership, they're not listening or they're not respecting it. And respect can take you a long way. So it's got a lot to do, I think, with the disconnect, got a lot to do with all of that. The leadership being absent, or if there is leadership around, the kids not respecting it. And a lot of people these days, for whatever reason, think that if they show respect, it's riding dick or
is kissing somebody's ass and they above that, they too gangster for that. But ain't nobody saying all of that a lot of the time. They just saying have respect, show respect. You ain't got to kiss nobody's ass. You ain't got to ride nobody's dick. You don't have to be a hater either. But at the end of the day, it's a balance. Like you keep saying, it's balance on everything. They just got to open their ears and be aware and listen and be ready to process it themselves and be one with God, be able to find themselves in life and know what's comfortable and what's, you know, where the balance is. I think that's missing a lot all the way around.
Yeah, give me some points. You know, I agree with you to a certain degree. And when I say that, yes, I believe if everybody had a sturdy father, I mean, we grew up, if you didn't have your biological father, we grew up to James Evans and Bill Kaiser, you know what I mean? From Fat Albert to Good Times. So we knew when James came home, no matter what Michael and J.J. and Selma was doing, they got right when their dad came in that house. They got right when their mama came in that house that they was strong. Spatter rod, spoil the child, and that's what it is. They ain't used to no ass whooping and that type of thing. So they think they're their own men and women to a certain degree. If your mother was a drug addict or your dad was an alcoholic and there wasn't that sturdiness in the house, then what the kids going to do? I learned a lot off the playground. You know, rather you came from a good family background, all the kids didn't. So they're going to bring their dark side ways to that playground and you're going to pick up on some things. So, and that'll lead back into your house. And if there's nobody there to correct it and keep that in perspective, yeah, the train going to go off the track every time, man. Every time.
And that's real, too, man. Yeah. I think a lot of times, too, you know, what? Because all of us came up at the time, you know, we had Richie Rich on a couple of weeks ago, and Richie Rich basically talked about what it took to get into the studio, and you actually had to be right before you got into the studio. You know, you just wasn't just jumping in. And what we have now with the modern advent of technology, you know, which is great in its innovation and creation for facilitating wide-ranging communications, but it has also, because of that convenience, convinced a lot of crappy rappers that they can actually be rappers. I mean, we're seeing, you know, a situation where, you know, camera equipment, I mean, look, 20 years ago, camera equipment, let alone having a camera crew, I mean, you know, a beat program, let alone having somebody who can make beats, and you still have to have someone to engineer, mix, and master everything. You understand the nuance of all the science behind the sonics for you being a producer. So what we have now are, in addition to a lack of stability at home for some of these youngins out here, there's a fundamental lack of musical knowledge in terms of what constitutes creating a complete product of consummate greatness. Mm-hmm. Everybody's trying to jump on a trend and ride it, but nobody understands the tireless efforts, the sleepless nights, the arduous authoring,
the fights in the studio,
the process of the progress, you know?
Right.
And now you got a lot of people coming. Go ahead.
Not cutting you off, just adding to it. The making of the instrument. Here again, shout out, rest in peace to Peter Tyre. He was one of the few guys that made his own guitar. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
When you're talking drums and anything that you're duplicating digital nowadays, it came from an original instrument. You see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So the guys that made the instrument, they go all the way back to this. But you know, go on from there, man. I just wanted to add that to you, man.
Oh, no, and I appreciate the input. Thank you. And definitely, but I think more than anything, what you have are a lot of guys who are concentrating more on Twitter followers, Instagram followers, and YouTube views rather than, you know, that social media does not substitute substantial achievement. And we're seeing a lot of these artists coming into the game right now who think this sensationalism and shock value is the key to success, where really it may get you a skeleton key in, but if you can't come with constant product, you're going to be padlocked for the duration.
I agree, man. Yeah, that's it exactly. Here again, you're going to run out of gas. You got to go back to the original source. Whatever it took to make it, you got to stay at that plateau or reach beyond it. You know what I mean? To go backwards, it's too close to nothing. So, I agree totally.
And I think the same thing you just talking about right now, I think that's what disappoints me so much is some of the people that have been around, have experience, they've had made hit records, and because they're not doing as well as they were in the past, they're seeing this from the modern day talented people, and they're reverting to that instead of going into the studio and bringing back another hit like they've known to be able to do. And I think that's what's so disappointing to me in hip-hop these days is it's so easy for people to start reverting to that and learning how to do the shock factors and all of that. And you're just like, damn, the one rapper that I used to like is like going off and dressing in wedding dresses and shit like that, you know, and that's what's disappointing in hip hop these days to me.
Yes.
Right. Yeah, I agree with that as well. Yeah, something I was going to add to that, kind of forgot about it, but you know, everything is funny. Everything is in the cell phone now. You know what I mean? From turntables and to microphones. It's all that arm reaching. And while he again is without knowing those rudiments, you kind of lack something at the end of the day. You know, at least the respect value, the quick money. A lot of guys, this is what I was going to say, get caught up in the hype. You know, if you see if you're struggling or starving artists in the back room, once they introduce you to that big party and all the girls and all the money, then the average person would rather stay at the party than go back to work and consolidate themselves back into the essence of what got you there in the first place. So how soon we forget to do it.
Definitely. And, I mean, when we look at it now, man, I mean, the game has changed so much. And I think also, too, is that we have to stop trying to, well, you know, I think a lot of times hip-hop, you know, and we have talked about this, you know, Illa, you know, King, you know, and Chinchilla, we've talked about this numerous times with many guests. I mean, there has to be this forced euthanization of the old guard in hip-hop has to stop. There's a difference when, you know, and I always get right tickled when Eric says the Larry Holmes going out like Larry Holmes, you know, when it's just so, you know, in that analogy, when it's just so visibly painful that someone can't do it anymore. But when you still have artists such as yourself, Ghostface, Raekwon, Kool G Rap, Kim, if he ever comes out with another album, and we want another Rakim album, you know, E-40, you know these rappers who were part of the old school who have still not only maintained cultural relevancy but have achieved and sustained a high standard of lyrical dexterity and articulation, excellence that lesser MCs are going to drown in those high waters because they can't swim in that type of, you know, scribing. You know, why is it hip-hop seems to be the only genre that tries to force out the people that made it great in the first place, some of the artists?
Here again, it's the lack of unity in the community. The same as drugs invaded us in the 80s, you know what I mean? We used to call cocaine a white man drug and all that, but once that infected our environment, then it tore our family, lineage, so... It's that same, like I say, young player Haitian denies not a respect for the elders, you know what I mean? And it's like, get out the way, you know what I mean? Let me put on your shoes and your suit and tie and sit in your seat, you know what I mean? And you don't know how the seat was created, why I'm in the seat, you know what I mean? Not willing to pay the dues to maintain the seat, you know. Everybody that say they're a boss, they got to understand this. The boss take the loss, you know what I mean? Like James Brown say, you pay the cost to be the boss. So without knowing that, you know what I mean, you get that far. It's like I give you a perfect example. They're going back to Egyptian times. And you look at the life of King Tut and his daddy before him that had a 17-year-old reign, the Pharaoh Akhenaten, and he went against all the gods of Egypt. Well, that naturally outcast him and Queen Nefertiti, and eventually, in some way, within his 17-year reign, he disappeared. King Tut became a king at 9 years old, that had all that great responsibility to wear his daddy's shoes. Not that he chose it, but by the time he was 19 or 20 years old, he was gone because the old guard and everybody else wanted to go back to old Egypt. He wasn't powerful enough to sustain that, you know what I mean? So they took back from that baby, you know what I mean, in a funny way, other than the Lord Jesus Christ, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the most famous king, you know, in the world today, and that's like the old ancestors blessing that child for what it was, you know, what great responsibility he grew into, that he, you know, had no way, you know, he naturally had to have a knowledge of it, but he didn't have, before he could stand up all the way and become a full man, the old head before him took it from him because he was that young a child that didn't know where it came from and was kind of forced into that great responsibility. But that's what's pretty much happening in hip-hop, man. The kids is taking over the house. I want to say, I'm trying to think of the bigger line, what he said, what's the name of the song? You know, Things Done Change. Where he say, even the kids.
Cool, Biggie. You know about Biggie with Things Done Change?
Yeah, Things Done Change. When he mentioned about, damn, how you put it? He was saying how the parents
now. Yeah, you sling crack work or you got a wicked jump shot?
Yeah, that's the joint. So he mentioned about how it been turned more, and the parents are scared of the kids. No more ass whoopings, and from the school system to the home front, you got a lot of wild, reckless kids. You know what I mean? And once a kid, it's like a young lion learn his strength. If his daddy not standing over him as well as he did and had that strength and wasn't taught to love him and respect him, then what are he going to try to do? Overthrow the throne. You know what I mean? So that's what's taking place, man. You know what I mean? And most so through our, you know what I mean, our history, and we ripped from Africa to here and don't, you know your beginnings to where you at, and everybody really don't know what it is and what to do. You know what I mean? It's like giving a baby $1 million. You don't know what to do with that, but you don't know somebody that cut his head off for it, too, at the same time. He's a child. So that's what's taking place in the world, and in particular, you know, all communities for that matter, but in particular the black community, man. You know what I mean? You know what I mean? Without having that proper guide, you know what I mean? You know, education of what to do with this, that, and the other, then you do anything. So, you know, that's basically what's taking place. These guys become a young millionaires at an early age, and you know what I mean? Not necessarily giving back to the place and not in the money sense where they come from and not even looking that far back to build and keep your foundation. When the lights cut off, you know, at a time in Africa, you know, people woke up when the sun went up and went to sleep when it went down because there wasn't no street lights. You know what I'm saying? You had the sun and the moon and the stars in the nighttime that keep the night lit. Other than that, roaming in that jungle, man, it's land, tigers, and bears. Oh, my. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah, it goes so many ways, man. It's just back to the beginning. So, like I say, as far as ancient wisdom as you can study, nothing new under the sun, man. So, you know, for those that know, yeah, that's just what's taking place. And, you know, all things must come to pass. So, eventually, like I said, at the end of the day, we'll all figure that out, you know what I mean? You know, it's God time, not all time. So in time, I feel like they'll decipher yourself along the way you did.
T-Max, he mentioned, and T-Max mentioned too about how the internet has changed the business model for how the culture is shape-shifting right now in terms of distribution and getting your records out there. And
right. You've
been independent for going on like 15 years now. And I don't think a lot of the youngsters, they still don't understand how much work it is in terms of the independence and compare this to the majors. Can you care to tell our audience, like, the difference? Like, what's the pros and the cons?
When you're doing it independently, naturally, unless you're able to pay for staff and have that foundation, the people that support you, you're doing everything on your own, out your pocket. Now, when you get that record deal, you might have a certain amount of money in your budget to be able to take care of your bills and kind of, you know, sustain your physical foundation. The rest is going to work. You do a whole lot of hard work from the radios radio stations to whatever, just branding your name, that song that you're pushing, then it's on again if you get another one. So, you know, like the Beastie Boy says, no sleep in Brooklyn, man. So the touring and all that, you're going to have to work. But imagine that if you didn't have a foundation or the type of finances to for sure you the next 6 months to a year. And whatever you're doing, it's all out your pocket, man. And it don't jump off like you expected. I got a hot song. But you saying you got a hot song. It's a million people in the world feel the same way. What makes you different than anybody else? So it's a hard work, a lot of faith and believability. You know what I mean? What goes up must come down. It's all trial and error. So sometimes, you know, we all get that lucky punch. You know what I mean? Bust and tuck. Douglas and Mike Tyson, but the next fight he wasn't prepared for. We knew him, you know, for what they consider 5 minutes of fame. But we know Mike Tyson forever for his longevity, and he was taught by one of the greats, you know what I mean, Costamato and what have we. So what's in him is in him forever. But but learning the game and the longevity of the game, yeah, you got to know when to get in and when to get out. And that take a whole lot of spiritual training, mental training, and physical training, man, to keep yourself here. You know, the older you get, you know what I mean? Your body starts to break down. We go through all these type of physical ailments. Everybody in the rap game, in the life game, is not just dying of murder. You know what I mean? High blood pressure, you know what I mean? It's, you know, with black folks, we get what I'm trying to say, sickle cell anemia, all kind of things, some things are traits. So we're not going to be here forever to be guessing and playing around with these games. So the sooner you know that, you know what I mean, the quicker you get on, you know, your life purpose and what you're supposed to be doing out here for the time is up. Yeah, we all going that one place before it's over with. So, you know, it's all about that. You know, learning the real life, you know, real life expect, how I'm trying to put it, you know, your real purpose in life, more or less. And get busy, man, you know, because it's for a limited time. You know what I mean? It's like having silent pig pals and you speaking on in the music game and you have a voice. You know what I mean? That ain't just for you. That go out to the world. You don't know what kid that may inspire to do what I did from hearing guys that I still hadn't met to this day. Don't know. I feel a certain way about records. You know what I mean? Certain like that. So I, you know, knowledge in so many ways. So, you know, in that sense, yeah. I say that'll correct itself the more, you know, we transpired throughout this life travel, man. One way or the other.
Yeah, man. This is just so much wisdom, man. I mean, this is the essential elements, you know, because, you know, of course we have, you know, all the elements of hip hop, but most paramount is the wisdom to weld all of those wondrous works. And definitely we got to get back to, you know, of course, because we covered so much. Going to the My Own album after you did, you know, after the success of your first, and, of course, just the glorious lead single Give and Take, what was the process of, you know, going into your sophomore effort with the momentum just rolling in your favor? I mean, you know, what were those studio sessions like in the creative process and ultimately the culmination of that product?
Well, it jumped off for me, like you said, 97, 98. So I was used to being that backroom kid when everybody else went out and partied and went to the clubs. I was staying up, you know, in the studio and stay at the house, which was the concentration camp foundation for our C-Lo records and wherever we had the studio props set up. I stay and work on those records. Just getting prepared, you know, for my first solo joint. But that was one side of it. The other side was touring, the interviews and so on and so forth that I wasn't going through as much the years before. So from that, when I say, you know, getting my feet wet or getting my feet on the ground once I went into California, I'm not in my backyard. You see what I'm saying? To capture and preserve that one thing that got you there is hard to do. You know, a dog is here in his own backyard, but he might tuck his tail when you take him a long way from his yard. You know what I mean? So that's a whole other possibility. So within that cycle, when I get to my own record, I want to say I did 14 joints on my Balls and My Words and 12 on my own record because I was due to do another record before I knew it. A year had to pass being in and out on the road, and I was due. Now, I had like a five-album contractual situation with Priority Records that only lasted about those first couple of years where I was able to put out my Balls and My Words in my own. So in that sense, you know what I mean, the first 10 to 12 or so joints, I didn't have a whole lot of time to go through it, really sit down, you know what I mean? Due to I had the guys, you know, certain guys around me that was producing, concentration camp producers and so on and so forth, I was able to pick like the first 12 joints and get busy, you know what I mean? I was a guy that if I worked a construction site or a piece of hut, I always kept napkins and a pen in my pocket to write down those, you know, short lines here and there, get back home and scramble it all out and put that together and make it a song. But that's how my mind clicked. Wherever I was, the music was. So I could do something else, but what's for you going to be for you. You know, again, you can't run for yourself. So in that sense, I had, I'm more like a visionary where I can tell you the next 5 to 10 years what my album's going to be and what my plan is for the next year to come. I'm going to drop this album this year, this album that year. You know what I mean? So My Own was the second album that I already had on my personal playlist. So a lot of people, I believe, misinterpreted that and was thinking I was saying I'm stepping away from No Limit and everybody else because I'm on my own. So or not. That wasn't the thing. It was just, you know, my, more like a family thing. That, well, okay, now I'm grown, or like Sebo saying, the straight killer, no more OGs looking over me, I'm on my own. So I was saying that, you know what I mean, in that sense of the word. So I grabbed here again the first 10 joints that I liked, between, you know, several producers, Happy Perez again, Steve Velo, and a guy, a friend of mine by the name of KC out the Kansas City area, produced that Minute to Breathe that everybody loves, as well as my man Carlos Wilkinson, we call Los for short, that produced at the concentration camp. So I grabbed those 12 beats, just laid out a pamphlet, and, you know, as the artist here, the two main guys that's on that record, and where people get it confused because there's no limit features on it. The only two major rappers I had out of, other than, you know, the few guys, Max Manella, Jay Vaughn, which was called Lay Low at the time of the concentration camp, and the original setting, Booty Balls Player, Lee Time, Bluff and Knuckles, my brother, so on and so forth, was Daz Dillinger and Too Short that gave it that major look, and, you know, that most sort of California look. Yeah, you know what I mean? So it was just really right. Me, Pimp, and Mama West used to talk on the phone for years before I even see Pimp in the flesh, you know what I mean? When I met Pimp in the physical, we was at a MJG show, and I was on tour with Party Records in like 98, when he had moved to Atlanta, you know what I mean? So I met him backstage at that show. Somebody came to me and said, Pimp on the holler at you. And he had, like I said, I've been talking on the phone for years. A lot of people used to hold me and tell me about Pimp before I knew he was really from Crowley, Louisiana. So the Louisiana old man said, man, you know Chad? Man, you got to meet my friend Chad. He'd be 50-60-year-old men in my neighborhood. Man, who is Chad? I had UGK records and all that, but I wasn't so, you know, when you first get a rap, a record, or however, you really don't know their real name. See, everything social media, man, you know, everybody know who you are. You couldn't reach out and touch a LL Cool J or whatever back then through social media. You'd be lucky if they came to the town. So I always hear about, you know, Chad or Pimp C, Vince, man, the old guys who tried to connect us. But shouts out to Trio, Turk and Mel. Mel was the first guy to put me on the phone with Pimp. And later on, within the years, when I got there, I always tried to do a record with Pimp. And I tell you, the only record you have in the world today that anybody that know, if you read the credits involved in my world you played earlier, was Brandon Norris. He produced that track for either the 504 Boys or Mystical album. And it had that open third verse when I was rapping at my album at No Limit. And Pete gave me that beat because I liked it. And I was able to explain that to Pimp before he died. And was glad I got it. But, yeah, man, so much come to mind. But Pimp, I brought Pimp up because when I did the song Time and Money on it, I was actually trying to put Too Short and Pimp on that record. And all us were still friends with each other. Short had moved to Atlanta, so I actually drove down with Happy and Lay Low, and we recorded in Too Short studio the Time and Money. Then we did a record for them, the group Bad Ways, that he put out at the time with a song called Make Money. You know what I mean? So on that same night, you know what I mean, I was able to record with Too Short for one of the first and only time, but we recorded two songs within that night. But in the midst of going to Atlanta, Pimp was, I say Pimp, I called him, I said, hey man, look, I'm on my way to Atlanta. He said, please, well, I'm on my way to H-Town. We're going to pass the jet on the slab. I said, well, I'm trying to wrap my album up. You know, I can speak on that now. And if I knew what I knew now, I probably would have changed my whole format. But just trying to keep up my contractual obligations with Priority Records, Pimp was like, please, give me $10,000, and I'll produce your whole album. You know what I mean? So I was like, Pimp, yeah, I ain't really got the time to do it. I got to turn my record in. But what I want to do is get you on this record with me in Too Short. So when I got the Short, I let Short know I wanted to put Pimp on it. He said, yeah, that's what you put on it. So for some reason or another, I could not get Pimp on that record, and I did a third verse added to what me and Short already had. But that's the makers of time and money off of my own record. But yeah, you know, that whole evolution. So it came out pretty good, you know what I mean? It's one of my better records, one of my favorite records. It didn't have the same commercial success that Balls in My Word had. I mean,
man, I mean, you know, and you illustrating all of that history, I mean, it definitely shows a strong, strong bond between the Bay Area and Louisiana. You know, and of course with, you know, of course, rest in peace, you know, Pimp C. Bun B once said that without Pimp, you know, hip hop is boring, and it's true because Pimp definitely brought a unmitigated boldness and swagger You know, Sweet Jesus yeah, Jones was definitely a one of a kind. You know, we go to the My Own album, and definitely and basically the years after that, you know, just, you know, doing music. I mean, you know, what was it like knowing that you were your own boss and that in terms of your vision you could realize and manifest your destiny for how you wanted your music to basically in the direction you wanted it to go in without, you know, the middleman trying to meddle in your business of how you did your business?
Right. Well, mentioning my grandfather earlier, somewhere between 9 and 10 years old, and definitely between about 10 years old, he passed away in like 84, 85. So I used to always sit on the porch with him and tell him, man, one day, hey, Papa, I'm going to own me a record company. So other than just being a rapper, I wanted to own the record company in that sense, you know what I mean, to make sure I had an outlet for my music. For once, and that's me just sitting on the porch with daddy. But later on, when you meet people in life, you naturally have to compromise and coincide. Other people's ideas come to the table, and that discourages a lot of people that's not open to that. You know what I mean? I can come out and say, I'm going to do this like this here and the other. You know what I mean? And that may work, you know what I mean? But you have other side, two heads is better than one. Sometimes that works, sometimes that clashes. So for the first time, I was coming from under that umbrella of worrying about turning in a record, and if Pete liked it, if Priority liked it, if C-Loaf liked it. So I started a label after the, you know, I guess I could say it like this, to follow Priority, which came somewhere within the time after the release of my own, when I was geared to do my third album, which is entitled Vintage. So like I said, I already had envisioned for the next 10 years that I wanted each of my albums, you know, to be titled and called. You know, and then definitely the five, you know what I mean? When I got busy with Priority, I just, you know, got busy doing records and just keeping up with the dreams and the music that was in my mind, body, and soul. But I'm saying that to say this, I started a label called Detention Home Entertainment. And coming off that big commercial blast, you know, once since forth back independent, but the guys at Selecto here opened up and gave me a distribution outlet. So I went to that, you know what I mean? So I didn't have any overhead. I compromised my marriage at the time, Uncle Polly, and different things like that. So we was kind of like the Otis and Blue, the end of the concentration camp. I regenerated and came back and started another clique called the Corleone family. So we started doing that and bringing in guys that played live instruments, that played, you know, drum machines or what have we. So when I did the record Vintage, everybody had different types of equipment, old and new. And we had the privilege of, I clicked with this guy, one of the greatest bass players in the world, rest in peace, Mr. Harold Coward, that had a 40-acre studio out here in, what is that, Prairieville, Louisiana, on the outskirts of Baton Rouge, that at the end of my own record, I used to go by and pay him for the session to finish up that album. And we took a liking to each other. He was about 30 years older than me. But he was the bass player to Andy Gill, the Bee Gees. He played on the Eagles Hotel, California.
Wow.
Yeah, he rocker. Yeah, he was an old rocker, so he opened that whole genre. And those type of friends that he had to meet, CPAs from California, Mr. Ron Cabot, and so on and so forth. One of the managers out of the Monkees, the rock group. So that whole white side of the rock game, you know, with him going as far as when those guys had a castle in England, the Bee Gees, you know what I mean? There's some people in the gear that want to say he OD'd in that castle, but they own private planes and stuff like that. So he hit me to a whole lot of game and business partners and lawyers and what have. He just gave me the best of that world to where he allowed me to come back and give me his guns in the middle of the night, go in the other house with his wife and leave me back there with all the guys that I wanted to bring from South Baton Rouge to anywhere in the city, and I could nourish my own craft without having anybody to tell me no, when, how, what to do, what. So that was a great feeling, but it didn't, he again didn't have the same commercial leverage that my boss and my word had. It was like Michael Jackson not beating Thriller. That was the number one hip-hop and R&B debut record for the Billboard charts, and somewhere between number 10 and 12 on the Billboard 200 and certified gold in 3 weeks. But naturally, my plan was if I can go gold, I could go platinum. So I wanted to be able to continue to flip records and just pick up where the last record left off and go up, up, and away with it. So But instead of that, I had a more of a down plan where the records sold less, you know what I mean? I still do 10,000 records, and, you know, the independent math with Pimp Them called Ghetto Gold, you know, that's $100,000, man, you know what I mean? So I still was living and eating and maintaining without the overhead structure, without, you know what I mean, the recoup of a record company. So it was kind of bittersweet in that sense, you know what I mean? So it worked out at the end of the day, and still to this day I maintain that 10,000 records or better. So, you know, good independent money. So a lot of guys, it's not about selling 100 million records and all that. You blessed, and that's it. God fly the frisbee too, and that's a beautiful thing. But if you learn the independent game, here again, I come from selling tapes on the street corner, in the corner stores, in the local record stores. So I had some kind of idea of hand-to-hand distribution. And once I got, like you said, I had both of those worlds, which you just try to describe to the youngsters, the independent world and the major world. So I learned a lot between those worlds and how to reconstruct and keep myself here to this day and so on and so forth.
And you mentioned, well, let me just, while you're on that thought, he mentioned the hand-to-hand distribution, and we always talk about how these new up-and-coming artists don't know a lot about that because of the social media, and they really don't have to work hard to get their music out there. But with what's going on with the social media and potential for it to start getting regulated, that's going to come in handy for people like you. You already do it. You know about it. You know how it goes down, and you're not scared of it. But these new artists and all of this modern talent, they're going to be kind of lost not having that skill and not knowing what to do or where to start with it, or even being scared to go approach whatever music shops or, you know, warehouse or whoever's selling CDs these days, or approaching people in the street wanting to know if they're about it. They're going to be really lost not having that kind of knowledge and willingness to get out there and do that. So for somebody like you that has it and knows how to do it, not scared to do it, that's going to be a big upper hand for you if, in fact, this world starts changing on the social media or the internet, period.
Right. What I call, and like you say, social media is good to a degree if you're utilizing it right. But what I tell a lot of guys, the summer of the time I have a show like this, and it's going to be a hell of a show. A lot of people going to woo, 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 woo. And I get to the show, and the only people that's at the show is the rappers that paid to showcase the show in hopes of me putting the record out or connecting with me. Maybe 20 to 30, 40 people when it's a 500 or better venue. And what I say is, hey, man, nobody got any connection to the Carmen Stove. You look at the James Brown movie. Nobody know the local DJ. Nobody did a radio commercial. Didn't get hands-on with the people, go to the park. Well, the people in the community don't know that I have a show there. By the time they call me tomorrow, man, I didn't know you was out here, because nobody got on the street and promoted that concert or what have you. But that's what, you know what I mean, what I call a lot of people got internet lazy, to where they believe just putting flyers and stuff on the internet gonna bring the masses of the people out. Now, you may get some people that's more internet prone, you know what I mean? But a lot of times, a lot of these guys, you know, refuse to even tap into that world, you know what I mean? A lot of people are so old school that they still want a CD. So I don't forget, here again, I keep the left leg behind me in that sense to where I come from. In efforts of, you know, this new world, this new wave of things, I'm with that. But I try to dominate and have the best of both worlds. You're going to do it all the way around. Don't do a half a circle. Make a complete circle. So here again, I always say this. If mama don't know I have a record out, then it's not reaching my community. And that's when I go and double back myself to make sure it's there. Yeah.
And then
Go ahead.
I was just going to say that also shows, like, where the financial part comes in. Like, as he was saying, if you're independent, you have to have the finance backing you, or if you have the label, you already have it there. When you can't fund the radio stations doing the commercials or TV commercials or something, that kind of cuts you off from the promotions for your concerts in the first place, and resorting to straight social media is not always going to do it, like you said.
Right. Exactly. So, yeah, I agree. And that's the thing, is just having the best of both worlds and, you know, getting up, you ever look at the James Brown movie, and you go out and tell him, hey, I want to promote my own show. That local DJ might be a fan of mine, so it might cost you a grip. You know, I could give him a few dollars or whatever his price is, and he's going to play the record not only within the sense of in the time frame of what I paid him for. If he loved the record, he's going to continue to play that record. So you then created a relationship right there. And every time you're in town, you pay your respect to the people that helped get you there. And it's nothing, you know, I'm that type of guy, and there's people like that that still exist. So, you know, we all got to eat his business at the end of the day. So, you got, you know, nothing from nothing to leave. Like, so it costs something. Yeah. So in that sense, you know, I mean, it's hard when you're doing it all out your pocket, forcing you to doing other things to once something starts to keep it going, or if I have a tendency to dying out. So that's the, you know, the record labels to me is like a bank for entertainers. You know what I mean? You go get this record loan to put out a record. Yeah, you know what I mean? But it's that great word, recoup. If your record don't, it's just like scoring from the dope man. If you can't pay the connect, then you lose that connect. You know what I mean?
You know, and you definitely make a great point, because I think a lot of times on the independent circuit, people love the idea of being their own boss, but they don't want to do boss shit to become that boss. You know, and you know, and people got to understand, when you're making mute, when you're doing an independent route, it is about going on the Chitlin circuit. It's about shaking hands, kissing babies, all that stuff in terms of interaction. You know, and I see a lot of situations, you know, from all over, you know, from where I'm at, you know, in VA to a lot of other places, you know, a lot of artists think there's some type of meritocracy just from being from the hometown that they're entitled to support. And I'm like, no, it's not like that. You have to get out there with the people and mingle and get your stuff out there, you know.
That's right.
You're going to make it.
Right. Nobody know who you are. You know what I mean?
Exactly.
So, yeah, you got to go some places, man. Take some pictures, you know what I mean? And let them keep you on the wall. People remember those times forever. And everybody, that's your support system when you drop. Now, they like the record or not, people take a chance just because you was a good person to them or show love and respect. You don't know love, you can't show love. So a lot of people don't know how to do that here again off the breaking of the family foundation structure. You don't know how to greet, you know, approach somebody and self-respect yourself and show them love and respect, and people don't want to see you come.
Yeah. And I always tell artists, too, you can't take for granted that just because you're from a particular community, that community is going to show up for you, because as we've seen so many times, you know, you'll go out and get a concert and people know about it, but people not going to show up to that concert, even if it's just $5, $10 to get in the door. But the second one of the mainstream rappers comes in and is selling their tickets for $120, you'll pay that shit for whatever reason. You can't take for granted that because you're from somewhere, that community going to come out and support you. You got to go mix and mingle. You got to go network. And like you said, even if it's just out in the community showing love and respect on a one-on-one basis, you don't have to do nothing too big. Just show that you're a good person and you're worth their time and support.
Appreciation, showing appreciation. I ain't too good. I ain't had, you know, like Pac said, don't be no entertainer and a stranger, man. I'm not going to keep supporting a guy that I don't see come around and not showing the same love, at least trying to reach back in whatever form you want to do that in. Sometimes it's just present. You know what I mean? That just show people I'm down with the program. I ain't got it. I'm still hood and not Hollywood. You know what I mean? But we all love that at the end of the day. You know what I mean? Yeah.
Exactly.
Man, I think, I mean, from this interview that we have been so honored that you have given us, I mean, we have learned so many elements of, you know, not only the roots of, you know, where you're from in terms of Baton Rouge, you know, the Delta history, your influences, the interactions, you know, the stories, I mean, the history, I mean, just, you know, the knowledge, you know, the more than anything, the respect, you know, that you have for the elders, and above all, man, your humility and your courtesy. We really, 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 truly, truly appreciate this, man. I mean, we definitely
Man, I always say this, it takes one to know one. I appreciate y'all for recognizing and showing love and respect to me. That go hand in glove. Like my man Yuckmoff always say, one hand wash the other, two wash your face, man. They go together, you dig?
We appreciate
definitely.
Yeah, we definitely, man. I mean, you know, we almost running out of time. I mean, but like, you know, but you know, look, I mean, tell us about, you know, where you're at on Facebook, MySpace, Twitter, you know, I mean, Instagram, everywhere, wherever,
Black,
whatever social media
Planet.
You're at. Yes, but
okay,
Black Planet
let me
too,
run
whatever.
Into you right quick. What you were saying, Mark?
Any social media you got, IG, Twitter, Facebook, Black Planet, MySpace, anything. I mean, and whatever new music you got, you know, just let the audience know, you know, what you got coming,
okay.
You know, for 2018, you know, where we can find
okay,
you
okay.
at online.
Okay, man, for starters, man, anybody that want to catch up on the album we mentioned earlier, it's called Living. It features Sebo, Big Mike, on Farm to the Ghetto Boys, Cocaine, you know what I mean, out the West Coast, Spice One, Yuck Mouth, Moby Dick, trying to see who else who I may be mentioning, and Dash Dillinger from the Dog Pound, and, you know, artists out of the Detroit area, certain, you know, up-and-coming artists over the years that I've been working with. So the album is called Living, man. You can go to www.trapdoorent.com. That's my personal label and personal website. For everybody else that's on the Facebook, you can go to my government page, Glenn Clifton, or go to the Young Bleed fan page. On Twitter, it's at Real Young Bleed. And on Instagram, it's The Real Young Bleed. So any of those,
okay.
man, yeah, I'm pretty much there all day. Hey, man, that's up.
Definitely, definitely. I mean, this is, you know, and before we go, I got to ask you about one particular song you did because, I mean, I have heard original and then I just have heard songs that just blew me away just from the whole flow. Your song, you know, Holla, you know, it just, you know, you use it. You know, you just use the Indian track on that Holla at Your Dog, for, you know, and I mean,
yeah.
that beat was seductive, like a bad bitch in heels walking with the titties and ass out as she give you that look. I mean, that whole, the song, I mean, what was the inspiration behind channeling that Native American vibe to bring something so soulful and organic?
Shout out to one of my producer's partners out in the Louisville, Kentucky area, man. The Pew Big Bro to me in the street. I stayed the house with him. I'm out in the Kentucky area, but his name is Sweat Hog. Sweat Hog produced, I want to say, at least 8 to 10 of those tracks on that Preserved album off of the Strange label with Tech N9ne that you mentioned. But at the same token, I heard that record. I wanted to do something to kind of, you know, jump off for the album, a little kind of up-tempo. And, you know, I got that same exoticness. My vision was actually a belly dancer, you know what I'm saying? But I felt like that, and that hook clicked with me, you know what I mean, for what I was going through. You know, it's pretty much saying, you know what I mean, whoever down with me, I'm down with y'all. If you ain't down with me, you ain't got to worry about me, you know what I mean, hollering at you. But it's kind of like a pot holler if you hear me. If you're down with me, holler at a dog, man. When you see me, you know what I mean? We, again, don't be no entertainer, no stranger. Holler at me, man. Let's make something happen. So I reach out to so many artists, and, you know, the majority come back, and some people, you know, they're doing their own thing. So that was that whole effort with that record, you know what I mean, with that type of, I'm finna say European, but, you know, however you want to take that exoticness, you know, in a worldwide way. You know, I like a lot of foreign sounds. The Balls of My World record is predominantly produced by Happy Perez, and I used to always tell Happy, man, you know, that's Mexican and Black together. That's two markets, man. That's a beautiful thing. I love the Mexican people, like Black folks, as well as all people. So I'm multi-cultured like that. So all those foreign sounds, and like I say, I'm so, you know, off the gumbo pot. I mean, if it's Mozart, anything sound good, like Double K used to do on B Street, I'm going to try to put it to a beat. If it's 2-3 seconds, you know, if it inspired me like that, then come back with that penmanship, and it's not all about me at the end of the day. I listen to voices like instruments. I know so many artists. So if I hear a crack that call for somebody, I'm going to reach out to that artist, big or small, and all the in between, and try to just mix that in the recipe, man, and see what we come back with. You never know.
Yeah. Man, definitely. But that is definitely one of the most original songs I've ever heard, and I think that's definitely, you know, you keeping the spirit of the culture alive in terms of that innovation and the creation in reference to showing that, you know, it's the craft itself is beautiful in terms of the art of rhyme,
yeah.
and that there are many dimensions
yeah.
to how that art is articulated and expressed. And
yeah.
I mean, you're a true OG of an
outstanding great. There's original gangster and there's other OG, outstanding great. You're both. So you got a dual, you know, you got a dual distinction.
Right. I say, look, like I say, you know, God Doppel is D-O-G. You know what I mean? However you want to look at that. So off for original origin, man, I appreciate that. That's what it do, man. I mean, he again, take one and know. Much love, respect, bro, bro.
Definitely, definitely. Where you at, King? You quiet back
there. Yeah, I'm
here,
right
cause...
here, man. Yeah, you good, man. And, you know, before we go, I'm gonna shoot one more question to you. And it's about that My Own album, because I was listening to that this week. And
oh wow, yeah.
I was listening to it this whole week, and I could tell the whole Curtis Mayfield flavor was dripped all over that joint, man. So was he like a major inspiration in that?
I'm definitely true story, man. You know, Superfly movie and soundtrack. You know, my pops put me on that real young as a child, so that became one of my favorite movies. And soundtracks of all time. How it's so hand in glove. He's even in the movie for a sucker playing live in the club scene. But I had the honor of reaching out to Curtis Mayfield, rest in peace, before he passed away. And he was explaining to my manager that particular sound that he used for Superfly. He strung his guitar a certain way. And I don't get his kids and nobody to sit down with him long enough after he was paralyzed the whole night to learn that. So I was actually preparing to make my way to Atlanta, sit down and learn from him. We talked about me learning how to play the guitar earlier. He was one of the pioneers that I looked up to way since the Impressions and all that when you go back to Curtis. So, yeah, he's definitely one of the greatest, you know, prophets or ghetto prophets and poets all time and you know, one of the greatest songwriters. So I'm always lifetime inspired by Curtis Mayfield, and in particular starting with the Superfly soundtrack and movie. And why I say that is, we all love Scarface, the movie. But at the end, Tony Montana gets murdered. But in the end of Superfly, he was one of the only guys that survived the dope game and walked away with $500,000. So you hear those Superfly samples in the bottom of my world. Look at it, you know what I mean? Look, I'm trying to get this, and if you're with me, let's do this in the beginning of the confetti song. But I didn't get the chance to reach out to Curtis till I made it My Own. I forget the name of that song that we sampled that featured me and Dad and Laylo, Max Minnelli, and Jay Vaughn. Happy produced it, and Steve Bilo sung on it, you know, and that kind of Curtis Mayfield familiar voice, you know what I mean? So, yeah, definitely that along the way, you know what I mean? Curtis Mayfield, yeah, he was a great inspiration to that particular song and that album and just having the access to him at the time. But unfortunately, before I could get down there, he passed away. So, here again, rest in peace to the great Curtis Mayfield.
Definitely, definitely. Curtis definitely was, man. You want to talk about writing that soundtrack to the pimp, you know, to the pimp symphony? He was a conductor in the most complete way, no doubt.
With that hustle sound and add to it too, man. You know, if he left me anything, he cleared that sample for me before he passed away. So yeah, shout out, once again to Curtis Mayfield, man, definitely. Really?
God bless him. God bless him and God bless you, you know, for being able to use it, man. I mean, that's something.
Yeah, man, definitely. Absolutely.
Definitely. Well, yeah, we about to go ahead and finish this show off here. We want to salute you for joining us, man. We've been...
That's appreciate you.
We've been soaking up this musical history and going through the journey of your illustrious career, man. We hope that you keep on making that banging music that we know and love.
Yes, sir. Y'all get ready for the new album, Water Life, man. It might be one of my my best album to date, man. So y'all stay tuned for the 218. Yeah, that's me.
That's
definitely.
Yes,
even
will.
On
the mascot saying that's what's up. The mascot gonna check it out too. You hear
him? You say what again?
I said, even our show mascot back there showing some love. He going to check out the music, too. You know, he be listening to the music. He give us his opinion, too, sometimes. That's our mascot in the background.
Okay. Yeah, I hear that. I was wondering what that was. What y'all got back there? German show, Pitbull, what's going
to
do?
Dog over there listening to the tunes Pitbull and everything. I think he listens to some of this mumble rap. Let me go ahead and turn it for him.
Look, I'm going to tell you something. If it's a pit, that's my can. I click with all the pit bulls around the world. I've raised over 100, man. So that's my love, them pits, man. Yes, sir.
Man, I used to love them pits until I got a boxer. And, boy, I don't know which one I like more. Maybe the boxer just because I got a family. But them pits go hard, but them boxers go hard, too.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I have a few boxers as friends. You know, I live several places around the country. And everybody that got a dog, majority pits, but a few boxers was jumping, sleeping in the bed with me, a futon. They come where I come. I walk through the dog. So I'm a, you know, I'm a dog keeper. Whatever the dog is, I know I'm going to get along with a dog and some of my fellow men. You understand? The man best friend. True statement,
yeah,
man.
Dog,
so, yeah,
the dog knows what's going
is,
on
man.
With
he's feeling his back.
The dog knows his sounds, for real.
Look, I've been saying this the whole interview. You know what I'm saying? I've been saying this to y'all the whole interview. God backwards is dog, man. D-O-G. You know what I mean? Without no rules, that's your most natural life. We stop for the police and everything else. But a dog is an understand because he's going to react off of his instinct versus anybody telling him. But, yeah, man's best friend. Yeah, D-O-G, man. God backwards. But, yeah, he's right
that's
there.
Right.
That's deep.
First up,
you know.
he co-signed it right there.
Yeah, you know, yeah, you know what time it is. It's a spirit thing, man. We just look like this, man. All one body of Christ, man. So, yeah, spirit out there all the way around the board. Yeah, I did.
Salute. Yeah, we about to end this joint here. Big shout out to Young Blue in the concentration camp. Big shout out to No Limit. Big shout out to our co-host, Still Out of Sandman. He couldn't be here with us tonight, so he's there in spirit.
Sure.
Big shout out to my barking dog right now. He's about to get this music here.
Yeah, put it in the ear, man. That's right, put it in the ear, man. Music calms the saddest beast, man. True statement. Yes, sir.
So y'all have a good night.
Okay, y'all do the same,
man.
We appreciate y'all having me.
Miss Lindsay, number 22 on your Christmas list. She taught your son cursive, how to show his work, and even how to say thank you. She's given him so much, you'd like to give her something too. And with the great holiday prices at Academy Sports and Outdoors, this year you'll finally be able to give to those you've always wished you could. Like number 22, Miss Lindsay. Because this Christmas at Academy Sports and Outdoors, for all for less means more.
Do you suffer from chronic CFED or can't focus energy drain? Try over-the-counter Vibrin. One tablet contains the same caffeine as a cup of coffee, but without the calories or coffee breath. Vibrin, caffeine, not coffee. Taking Vibrin may result in a lack of drowsiness, improved productivity, and better cash flow from decreased coffee spending. Unexpected job promotions have been associated with Vibrin. Vibrin may decrease the urge to zone out, doze off, or exhibit signs of slacking. All jokes aside, always read the label, take only as directed, and limit caffeine as it may cause real side effects. Not for children under age 12.